I mean, I did everything to get the money, to get some more. I sold a rusty screw off the ground to try to get 2 cents, a dollar, to mount up to another. Let me tell you what I did. I just let go and I prayed for humility and patience. This is something that you have to pray for. Me, I do. You just don't walk up on it and get it. Pray for this. Ask God. He is the one that I got in my life.
All right, now, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the program the fabulous Aradney Foster. We sure enjoy your music a lot.
Oh, thanks very, very much, man. You know, anytime anybody's listening to it besides my parents in their living room always makes me happy.
Start at the beginning. Would that be all right?
Absolutely. Go right ahead.
You were born in Del Rio, Texas.
Baby, take my car keys, put them in your pocket. Lord knows I got no business with them. I've been nursing half a beer for half an hour, but the whole room's spinning.
How old were you when you first learned how to play the guitar?
I want to say about 10 or 11 years old. My dad played. My dad was a lawyer in Del Rio, and it's a fairly small town, and we were a long way from television. So when I was a kid, you know, entertainment was, you know, somebody would bring the potato salad, somebody would bring the barbecue, and somebody bring the beer, and everybody brought an instrument. And I fell asleep many a Saturday night on somebody's lap, you know, listening to my dad and all of his buddies play music.
So you ended up leaving home to attend college at the University of the South in Suwanee, Tennessee. And,
that's correct.
Listen up, y'all. We're gonna count this down.
Everybody, I'm Radney Foster. Come join us for the revival. When I was 20 years old, I woke mom and daddy up in the middle of the night, 3 days before I was supposed to be back at school. I told them, Mom and Daddy, I got something that's really important and I've been meaning to tell you for a long, long time, and it's heavy on my heart. And I gotta tell you. And my mother said, oh good God, what is it now? And I said, I think God wants me to drop out of college so I can be a singer and a songwriter. And my dad sat bolt upright in bed and said, son, I've known God a long, long time. And I don't think he wants any son of mine to drop out of college to be a songwriter.
When your parents are paying your way to college and you have one more year left, he would never tell you to do that. So that's, you can cancel that.
But they cut a deal. They let me go.
His dad said, well, if you can get a leave of absence for 1 year, you can go to Nashville and try it.
And then, of course, that didn't really work out. I was spent a year in Nashville and nothing happened, so I went back and finished my last year of college knowing that it's like, I don't think I'm ever going to do anything with this degree, but it also is so hard that if I don't, you know, and, you know, a deal's a deal. I cut the deal with my parents and nothing happened after a year, so, you know, you know, get a dime out of us. You got to root hog or die. You know, of course, you know, that's the same dad that, you know, as I was driving off, slipped me $100 and said, don't tell your mother I gave you this. You know, that kind of thing.
Well, the thing about Radney and I working together back then was that we were both two of the youngest guys at the publishing house that had signed both of us. And we were signed within like 6 months of each other.
Well, they said it over. Intuition don't mean a thing till the fat lady sings.
Some of the best gigs we did, unexpected, where you go into a place and you kind of look around and go, I don't know if I like the looks of this. And then the crowd shows up and it turns into a real magical thing.
When I heard Crazy Over You, it was just, you know, I mean, I liked country music. I thought it was cool, but I didn't know anybody could sound like that.
We're fixing to go in and make Foster & Lloyd's first CD, and I just thought about rodeoing and Texas and home, and you know, what would describe that? What would describe where I'm from and what it's like to dream that big dream? And here I am on the cusp of, you know, it's like a guy getting to ride in the national finals or something, you know, and go to Vegas, you know, and that kind of thing. So I thought, well, what I'm about to accomplish that. What's that feel like to, you know, what's the metaphor? And that's how I wrote Texas in 1980. So here it goes. I can hear the wind whisper my name, telling me it's time to hit out again.
My horse was a trailer and the lights are shut down, and I'm long overdue, heading out of town. Like a cowboy from the past, like Texas in 1880.
For a while there, it was, you know, we were blowing and going, really having a big time. And I cut Texas in 1880 with him as a duet, obviously a song he'd done before, and I got a lot of radio around Texas. And so, you know, I guess everything I've ever done with Radney has turned to gold. And
then he put out Del Rio, Texas.
Just call me lonesome.
Up until that point, nobody had really put out a record to me. You know, that really changed how I heard music. That really was a big moment of, wow, I found what I was looking for.
I wasn't aware of Foster on Lord when I first met Radney. I was aware of his first record, Del Rio, Texas.
Nobody wins, we both lose.
I was doing work over Heirs to Austin in Nashville. I met up with Radney and I started listening to all this breadth of work from Foster on Lord, and I started going, oh, I remember that song. You know, I remember certain songs. I go, I just didn't have a name connection with Foster Lloyd with him. You know, just face, name, and song. Just knew what I heard on the radio. But that's how I met Radney. And that's, it was just where he was and who he was at the moment.
From here until closing time, it won't matter.
Foster and Lloyd fan, although it wasn't until Radney's solo record came out and he cut his hair that I thought, that guy is fine.
When he first got his Arista deal and we went to New York to perform up there, it was for Clive Davis and all those guys. I mean, he just kicked ass and took names, as Radney always does for that matter. But I remember Clive Davis was standing there next to me and he just reached over to me, you know, whispered in my ear going, man. You know, he was just completely knocked out. And there's Clive, who has seen so many people, I mean, so many artists from all different genres and types and all. And it was really, that was one of those chill moments when, you know, but there's been so many of them from the time at the Continental Club in Austin when we cut that live record. I think Radney gives me chills every time I see him. It doesn't even matter.
All the trust my life's killed resurrects some old feeling.
You can never predict when you're going to have big transitions in your life. They come at you, you know, like a roller coaster ride. And certainly that was true when I was making See What You Want to See.
God hears amen wherever we are. I love you.
You know, I'd just gotten married, and so Cindy and I were newlyweds, and yet my son was going halfway around the world, and we were both just devastated, and yet crazy in love with each other. And so, you know, it's this constant emotional roller coaster going on in our lives, and I just wrote about it. I think that's the only thing I've ever really done in life, is just sort of write about what's going on. And
Jewel moved when we'd only been married for a year, and my mother died, and then the next week was when Jewel had to leave to go to France. So that was a really, really tough time.
His mom and I divorced when he was little tiny, but I had joint custody. She remarried a Frenchman, and when he was 5 years old, I did everything in the world to try to keep him, and literally changed my career to try to keep him in the States. And I failed, and he moved France with his mom. And so for the last 13 years, I have been a dad from 5,000 miles away.
See What You Want to See came out when I was at Country Music Magazine. And I knew what was going on in their lives, you know, through Cindy, and because it was very public when Jewel was taken to France. And I did the story for Country Music Magazine and interviewed Radney. And, you know, it was a very emotional time in his life. And something shifted, I think, in our relationship then, where it became more than just journalist, artist.
Radney's bigger than the Texas songwriter. I mean, it's, you know, obviously it's just an opinion. But I mean, he's always gone back and forth between those worlds, but not at the expense of anything. It's just who he is. I mean, you know, you're born and raised someplace you don't have much choice about. But I would never classify Radney as just a country artist or just a Texas artist.
But for me, it's kind of bigger than that. You know, you think of Johnny Cash. Well, what was bigger? Johnny Cash, the man, or Johnny Cash, the music repertoire? Well, who knows? You know, with Radney, I think, you know, it's a similar situation. I mean, his music stands on its own. It stands for itself. But Radney, the persona, is right there with it. I mean, what's bigger, Radney or Radney's music?
When you and Lloyd were recording your first records, did you realize that you were creating such unique music?
No, hell no. You know, why are Rank and File and Jason and the Scorchers rock band, and why are you guys and Steve Earle country artists? And we said, I think rightly so, because they got signed to pop record deals and we got signed to country labels, and we dialed ours 10% one way and they dialed theirs 10% the other way, you know. It's kind of the way life works.
There are some people in the mainstream country world that have thought Radney was too rock. And there are people in the rock world that, no matter what Radney did, said it had a twang to it.
When I left Arista, I knew that I wanted to do things my own way and independently. And so I didn't think, well, I need to find an independent label that wants to do something with me, or I didn't look for any of that. I just started to build it. It's very obvious to me that, you know, See What You Want to See is one of the bigger records of my career, artistically. And I was using the team of Daryl Brown and Nico Bolas when I did that.
Daryl called me up about 10, 15 years ago and said he's got a friend named Radney, he wants to record him. And he wants to do something completely different. What are you doing? So I showed up.
Those guys really helped me foster something that I don't think I could have done on my own, and they pushed me. They pushed me really hard.
Daryl, do I need to do another one, or have you got it?
Oh, we were sleeping, honey. Were you singing?
Hush.
And in good ways, there's some funny stories about that, too. That, you know, I mean, I think it's the first time I ever stormed out of a studio was working with those guys.
Wrong.
This is not Radney Foster.
This is better right there.
Oh, there we go.
This is my favorite kind of artist, I like to tell you.
But they weren't afraid of that. And so that was, you know, that was kind of cool.
There was an attitude about that record too, which I think for me as an artist resonated deep with me. It was the kind of like, screw it. I'm just gonna go and make this record. I don't know what it is. I don't know if it's rock, I don't know if it's pop, I don't know if it's country. I don't know what it is. It's just a record. And I think taking off all the parameters and limitations of everything was exactly why that record was so damn good, because it ultimately came about, it was about songs.
If he couldn't tell me genuinely why he wrote the song, and if it wasn't about his family, himself, something personal, something going on deeply personal with himself, I didn't care if it was a number one record. If I didn't believe it, from an artist standpoint, from a listener, from a fan point, it wasn't going on.
I think every writer, every artist writer particularly, has a point in their life where they're in a place where what they have to say resonates with a lot of people. And for better or worse, and I guess in Radney's case a lot of worse, that particular time of his life yielded that record and those songs, which on that album, on See What You Want to See, it's unbelievable. I don't remember another record that hit me in the way that every single song it hits me.
I've known Randy 15 years. I just found out that he's a famous songwriter.
Yeah, the Randy Fox, he's in my cell phone. I want to just show people. I know him.
Randy doesn't know this, but I've been a member of his fan club for a long while, but it's under a pseudonym, so... I'm updated with the newsletters and I know what's going on.
I had no idea. I just knew him. That's Radney. You know, he's just my buddy.
This man right here, turn around. This guy right here lives in George Jones' first house in Nashville. So I got George to sign him.
Are you kidding me?
Look what he says.
To Nico. Enjoy the house. George! Oh my gosh! How the hell did you get this?
You gotta know somebody, you know?
He's a country legend, you know, that's why.
Radney is a strong communicator, so he becomes very personal and you feel appreciated by him, but he treats everybody equal.
More than anything, I mean, these guys are my best friends, you know. So is he, you know.
I wouldn't go that far.
I think it's great that, I mean, I learned so much by being on the road with these guys. Rodney takes great care of the people that he's with on the road. He's been so good to me.
He really is a nice guy. He'll do anything, you know, for you. As a friend.
This isn't a big, you know, kiss Radney's ass thing. He really is a nice guy. A very nice guy, very talented guy.
It was just over 10 years ago that See What You Want to See came out. Come to right now, Radney and I were writing. And just write, you know, just, we always kind of knew where a path was by what we were trying to write and communicate. And Radney and I have a really interesting way of writing. We don't edit each other. We had a song come out of us called Little Revival. I thought maybe it was something that might be good, but I didn't know why. Well, all of a sudden, Randy started picking up the guitar and started strumming a tempo, and next thing you know, this song started coming out. And then when this song got done, I went like, oh my gosh, there's something unbelievably interesting about this. And it just kept on haunting me. And for the next 2 or 3 days, I said, Randy, I know what your record is.
I'm Roger Krager. Welcome to the revival.
Look at that boy in the river, soaking wet with faith. Look at that girl on the courthouse steps, saying things gotta change. There's that woman on the corner, handing out coffee in the word. She's listening to the working girls, the ones that never get hurt.
I'm a little scared of the word revival. I mean, it's got some, if you're in the South and you're talking about revival, to me it's a little, I mean, you know, there's that side of it that I think of, it's like coercion, or you're going to have to get redunked or something. There's something that's going to happen to you that feels a little intimidating to me. I think revival to me means my heart's on fire again, and that I am ready to go out and try to love the world again and try to wake up tomorrow and not worry about if I'm inspired or not, but just know that there is work to do and I am geared to do it.
Playing a big benefit show tonight in San Antonio, and we just got through making a brand new CD called Revival, which is really kind of full circle for me. And it's really about, you know, 12 years ago, my son, when he was 5, my oldest boy, left for France. Now he's coming home to go to college and is going to be in school 2 miles from my house.
His son Jules, who was taken away to France, and when Godspeed came out to See What You Want to See, you have it completed with him coming home. So here's a rebirth of that relationship.
When he started talking about this record and possibly Revival being the title track,
right, I mean, in my head, and of course I know all of his other songs, I could just automatically just start picking them, and there's just a common thread, and it's what this record kind of had to be about.
Well, you know, I've been lucky to be living with this record for a while, since Rodney has been in the studio, and he's been sharing it with me since they started, and in my personal life, I've been going through kind of a hard time. So Revival for me has become kind of a theme song about picking myself up every day.
Sequencing a record is usually like trying to sequence a show for me. But this record was completely different than that. And I really wanted it to tell a story so that someone could sort of follow it.
What does Revival mean to me?
It means a lot of things, but I think ultimately, I feel like, you know, everybody's always kind of searching for their own spirituality.
It's the best way I can say it. It's just like a rebirth.
Lap two? You know, you got through the last corner and you're back down on the straightaway.
The theme of this record, I think, has more spiritual themes to it than any record I've ever made. I certainly have never shied away from that, and I think that that's always been an element to my songwriting, because it's an element to my life. But I've never felt comfortable being sort of overt and really sort of writing a gospel record. And at the same time, I don't think this is one, but it certainly has put the spiritual aspect of my life front and center more than at any other time.
Revival means restoring self-faith in human beings, especially because everybody seems to be so self-centered. Everybody just needs to start looking out for everybody else, help somebody else, pass it on. You know, do something good to somebody else, and someone else will do something good to someone else. And then sooner or later, they're gonna it'll all come back around, because it's the full circle.
My name is Kristen, and I recently just graduated from the Magdalen program. Before I came to Magdalen, I had been diagnosed with hepatitis C. My viral load was so high that it would just, like, I would have seizures, I would have blackouts. Guy that I was buying drugs off of got into my cell phone, he called my mom, told her where that I was to come get me because I was gonna end up dying. So my mom picked me up, they took me, my dad handcuffed me to the inside of his truck, and they brought me down here. When I got here, I was very, very sick, and I just seemed like I stayed sick all the time, and I finally went to see my doctor, and he said, you're gonna have to go through interferon. So after 6 months, I started feeling better about the fifth month, and after 6 months, they tested me again. And most people, after they go through the interferon, they still test as a carrier, and they can always pass it, but it's not actively making them sick. Hepatitis C is no longer detected in my body, period. And that's my revival.
I'm Darden Smith.
I'm Monty Warden.
Welcome to the revival.
What he said.
God damn, man. We're in music business. Timing is everything, man.
One more time. All right.
Yeah, that's a good one. I'm Darden Smith.
I'm Monty Warden.
Welcome to the revival.
When we put the record together, when we started doing the first day of recording, he wanted to use his band. And when he starts doing Revival,
look at that boy in the river.
I can't hear any bass. Right, they just start playing like this little train groove, and they're playing, and everyone's playing their stuff. And I came out, and I go, whoa, 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 whoa. What's the train groove on this song?
and you guys gotta be talking to each other more music-wise. I just told Justin to stand up and just stand up. Get a little more vibe. It's too rote.
You are not a country train playing band. I don't believe any of it.
Right. It's just I need just your body naturally into it. So I'm just gonna say, like, Justin, get up and go, like, I want to feel that dip. And you're looking too much at your snare, and not at bass player, right. And not them. In other words, and you know, and that's it. So I mean, great thing about you is you just have to kind of go, next section's coming. You know what I mean? Right. Everybody else is looking at chords, but I got to get you off the snare and look at him. Because I'm trying to communicate with you, and I can't even get your attention unless I throw a pencil at you. Okay. So
and what's really Randy's always loved about our relationship, and he's told me this, is that I will push him to no end. If he's uncomfortable, and I got him on his toes,
something new is going to come out.
The tempo, I think, is good.
Yeah.
But if you turn up so that there's some crunch,
oh, yeah.
And maybe if you play with sticks.
Can I get more click, too?
Yeah, but are these the right sounds?
It's for click?
Mm-hmm. I mean, I know it's just a guy, but you're kind of playing with the tambourine instead of... If you had just a hard click, you might hate it enough to really beat the shit out of you.
I said, what's your favorite music? And the drummer would tell me something like that. I said, then play like that. You know, I just say, everyone be themselves. If everyone can be themselves in this, this record's going to sound real. If you start lying, if you start trying to play what you think somebody wants, you're going to screw it all up.
Look at that boy in the river, soaking wet with faith. Look at that girl on the courthouse steps, saying things gotta change. There's that woman on the corner, she's handing out coffee in the word. She's listening to the working girls, the ones that never get hurt. Every time I think I'm lost, this world's nothing but luck. God always sends someone down.
What key are we in forgiveness?
A minor.
Play some hi-hat there for me, brother, and count me in.
So forgiveness, we actually started that song after a writing session that we had over at his studio at his house.
Jay Clementi sort of pushed my buttons one day, and I was sort of rocking out to this... On this guitar, on my Les Paul Jr., because he was like, we need to write something that's up-tempo and that rocks, you know, and...
I said, let's see how soundproof this studio is in the neighborhood, so he cranked it up, and we just started just jamming on this thing, and it was just feeling really, really good.
All these melodies were coming out, and things and thoughts, and he just really got in my face about it, in a lot of ways, about, you know, what's this really about?
We kind of had a vibe for it, and then we ended up getting together again, and he had the title Forgiveness. And
it came around, we had the idea about forgiveness, and like, you got to figure out what forgiveness is really about down for you.
Well, I don't think it's ever too late to learn to sing a different song. I pick up those tools you left out and put them back where they belong. I can't handle yet what hurts me the most.
If you hate somebody, you're the only one who gets hurt. They could give a shit. You're the one walking around with all that stress and pain and anguish and everything else, right?
I think forgiveness is one of the most important things we have as humans. For some reason, I do not have the ability to hold a grudge against someone. I never have been able to do that. I cannot stay mad at people. No matter what has happened, if you can forgive that person, it's one of the greatest feelings.
I mean, God wants us to forgive ourselves because God is love. And there is nothing more loving than forgiveness. And that's the path to freedom, and that's the path to wholeness, and that's how we're created. I mean, we're not separate from creation, we're part of it. You know, it's moving towards wholeness, and there is not wholeness without forgiveness.
You know, we've just been talking about Jewel. I, for the most part, I wrote forgiveness for his mom. Because I probably have had to learn the hard way that we had to figure out how to forgive each other.
Everybody, I'm Julian Foster, and welcome to my revival.
Daddy was incredibly understanding that life happened to people, you know, that it was messy, and that, you know, he was a lawyer, you know, so, I mean, in a lot of ways, he was, you know, he spent his life helping people who were in trouble.
If you look up gentleman in the dictionary, Johnny Foster's picture should be there. He was the consummate gentleman.
He wasn't one of those guys who thought, yep, that's it. I'm abandoning you. God's abandoning you. It's all over from here, you know.
But as an attorney, if you hired him to be your lawyer, when it came time to be an attorney, he could get in the courtroom and be as scary as an SOB as you'd ever want to see. But when he walked out, he could go right back to being that gentleman again.
One thing I can always say about my dad is he was always very fair and very honest. He was always the kind of the cohesive glue that kept my family kind of rolling along really well.
I mean, my dad was an everyday angel.
He really was.
Yeah. One of those guys, I mean, an exceptional, extraordinary human being. To know him was to truly love him. I remember he used to drive us all crazy. We'd be in a hurry getting somewhere, and he'd always stop and speak to doormen and janitors and waiters and just people doing hard jobs. And Daddy used to always say, you know, honey, just do something for somebody else. It'll make you feel so much better.
You know, more than anything Daddy might have said, I just think that kind of stuff was the biggest lesson. And people who came up, you know, come up to me to this day still and go, you know, your dad did something for me that you'll never know what it meant to me. You know, that when I was in my darkest hour, your dad was the guy who was there. When we first found out that Daddy had cancer, I stayed in the hospital. I flew down immediately when they were doing the testing, and I spent the two nights with him in the hospital on the little fold-out bed so that my mom and my sisters and my brother could go home and sleep. And Daddy would wake up every couple hours and want to talk. He told me things I'd never heard. He told me things about when he was a teenager. He told me things, all this stuff. Those are two of the best nights of my whole life. You know, you don't get that kind of opportunity very often with your dad. And it was really cool. It was really, really cool. It was a Wednesday night, and Mama had something she had to do at church, and Daddy and I were having dinner together. And he was telling me a joke about a guy buying a suit. He gets halfway through it, and he's after dinner, you know, and he gets halfway through it, and he looked at me just as hard as I've ever seen him look. He said, son, he said, I need to go lay down right now. And I said, are you hurting, Daddy? He said, yes, I am, son. And I wheeled him into the bedroom, and I put him in bed, and I got him some painkillers. And really, that's the last fully lucid moment that he had. Certainly the last time he was out of bed. So I definitely got my chance to tell my dad goodbye. But I'm gonna have to wait till I get to the next world to hear the end of that joke. The night my dad passed, I was in Chicago. And I was playing at Joe's Pub, and my sister called me at about 6 o'clock in the evening. And the world stopped, and I didn't know what to do with myself. And so I called Ebo, and I said, cancel the show. And I just walked the streets around Lincoln Park for 30 minutes, not really knowing what the heck I was going to do, and trying to figure out if I could get a flight out. And I realized I couldn't, that there was no way. And I thought about my dad, and I thought about what he would want me to do. And I called Ebo back up, and I said, and he goes, we're playing the show, aren't we? And I said, yeah. He said, that's what your old man would want, Red. So we did, and I don't remember anything about it. It's just a blank to me, other than halfway through, I ordered a shot of Jameson's from the bar and had the entire uptie of Joe's Pub in Chicago toast my dad.
I just think God has shown me that it works better to be positive and look for the good in everybody and know that, you know, we're going to all get revived and get going. And if you have a bad day, always remember what your dad said. He said, well, just get up and go do something for somebody that needs it and you'll feel better. So.
That's awesome. It's a good place to stop.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
I love you, Mom.
Thank you. You'll be an everyday angel,
the kind without wings. To me, this particular record is, is a very personal record to Radney. I think it's pretty obvious when you listen to it. I can't hardly even listen to I Know You Can Hear Me, because I knew his daddy so well. You know, it kind of gets me. I can't talk about that one.
I Know You Can Hear Me was written by myself and one of my dearest friends, Jay Clementi, and who, a week after I lost my dad, lost his grandmother, who was really, really close to him.
I was ready to write this song about, you know, my grandmother that had passed away, and I know that, you know, he probably wasn't ready to write one about his dad yet, but it was just kind of writing it itself, and I had some lyrics down, and he heard this. Actually, it was going to be called The Beautiful One, and then I had a couple lines, and I said in it, I said, I know you can hear me, and his eyes just lit up,
and it hit me like I was in a car driving as fast as I could against a brick wall. You know, it just really, really hit me. And you know, Jay is a good enough friend that, you know, he's the kind of guy I could break down in front of when it did, and said, you know, I don't know that I'm capable of it either, but we're going to start that today, and that's what we're going to do, because I can't do anything else, because I'm not going to be able to focus on writing some happy love song right now. You know, it's just not going to happen.
This song has been, I feel like it was written, and we just had to reach up and grab the words, but it was incredibly painful doing that. I mean, all the way down the line. I mean, we knew it came easy, but it was incredibly difficult at the same time.
And we finished that song that day, and it was one of the harder days of my life and one of the greatest days.
Radney's always had the ability to draw out emotions in people, you know. You can't listen to Radney songs, whether performed by him or performed by someone else, that don't bring out, you know, your emotion.
I don't remember what it was, but like every kid I screwed up, probably gave some lip, probably threw a fit, and pushed until he'd had enough. I ran into the closet and figured I was hiding from a whipping. standing by the door that day, all that he did was say, I know you can hear me, you don't have to say a thing. My love is stronger, lasts a lot longer than your anger or your pain. You need to say you're sorry, son, you can come out whenever you're ready. And I know you can hear me. I left on the with the world, got knocked down plenty of times. Day or night, wrong or right, Dad's words would ease my mind. Still giving, lying there fighting to live. I couldn't find the words, so I used his. I know you can hear me, you don't have to say a thing. Love is so strong, you're not alone. No, I know that you're in.
I can't do this one right now.
Nine the Ranch. This is the Morning Ride with Rebel and Haywood. It's 12 minutes after 7 o'clock. High today, 105. It's going to feel like 108, so there's the joy for your morning. I tell you what, let's get a look at we do have a special, you hear giggling, we have a special guest in studio, and I don't want to give it, should I give it away?
Haywood? We don't want to give it away.
It's Randy Foster. He walked right by, and I was like, went out and tackled him and drag him in here, and he was going to come in and talk about a bunch of stuff, a big revival going on.
Big one.
A big, huge revival. And
Revival in Texas music, big revival in life, big revival in lots of things.
You know what? I think I've got like about 15 things that need revival. Grassroots
come on,
movement,
girl.
Baby.
Hey.
But I also need to touch on the people who come to you to ask you to produce their albums.
Yeah, that's been a new sort of thing in my life. I always produced my own records in some capacity. Certainly starting with, you know, Foster and Lloyd, Bill and I produced those records ourselves. Mm-hmm. And it was kind of perfect because we could bounce ideas off each other and tell each other no, you know, kind of, you know, butt heads a little. Bit.
He's not only a friend, a brother, someone that we look up to, someone who is a Texas troubadour, Del Rio, Texas born, great, great singer, songwriter.
I don't know how they would even relax around you. I mean, you're a legend in your own time.
Well, I don't know about that. I'm a legend in my own mind.
I don't think so.
He's such a good, not only an inspiration to so many of us, but he's a good friend to so many people, and he comes around the music and this scene quite a bit. So he's constantly around and constantly available for us to kind of say hello and pick his brain quite a bit, which is what I try to do.
I actually really started with being approached by the Randy Rogers Band, who just kept bugging me. They were opening shows for me back then. Now I open shows for them, you know. And I kind of held Randy's feet to the fire. I think that was one of my first lessons in mentoring, you know, a lot of the guys here at home. I've always encouraged every one of them that, you know, I see or play shows with. It's like, guys, you know, go write.
That's what I love about Radney. He's a great songwriter, and by the way, he's also played many of our benefits before. Very generous, very kind, and I also know that he mentors a lot of these young artists. If anybody knows the importance of bringing young artists along, it's Radney Foster.
Have you ever won a Grammy before?
I have never. I've been nominated twice for a Grammy.
Okay, you've been nominated twice. You have several, you know, song credits to your name, and you've had all these great accolades as far. You must be thrilled that you're number 57 on Bubbling Under on the Texas Music Charts right now.
I am thrilled that I'm number 57 because the single's not really officially out until Monday.
That is good.
So if we're already on the chart and we're not really supposed to be even exist until Monday, that's good. We're okay.
His music. It's important, but just as important is he makes sure that these young artists get a good footing on how to do this thing called the music business.
Genuine Austin original 98.1 KVET.
217 hanging out. Radney Foster, big party tonight. It is officially Radney Foster month, his birthday. He's turning 50 years young. Tonight's the big show.
And now, you guys are lucky you're in here.
My name is Roger Krager.
Kevin Fowler.
I'm Corey Morrow.
Why are you here?
I think we're all here to get Corey Morrow out of jail. We're all here to pay homage to one of the guys who really actually blazed the trail for us.
But I think when Randy was like right at the, he was really hitting hard when I started playing guitar.
Happy birthday! Who wants to get Randy to get spanking? Anybody?
Hey everybody, I'm Pat Green. Welcome to the Revival. Y'all have fun now. You here?
If you look back on things that changed, none of that Del Rio record. Oh God! Tell me that when that record came out, that y'all did not just do yourself.
Well, it's not so much I don't like him. I can't stand him.
Anytime any of them say anything nice about me, I'm always incredibly flattered.
That's the thing about Radney. He's very good.
Very good at what?
Sure.
Talking about himself?
No, songwriting. I'm being serious here. I'm trying.
Really?
It's a film, Monty. Come on,
I'm
going to put this out.
I don't make films. I make movies.
I'd be the greeter at Walmart if it wasn't for these guys.
Well, what's wrong with doing that?
Hey, Radney. Happy 50th. Old bastard.
Can't believe the guy is 70 years old. Can't believe it. You know, he doesn't look a day over 50, really.
Hi, folks, I'm Leroy Parnell, and welcome to Radney's Revival. Survival.
Sorry, can we redo that? I didn't realize he's actually 50. Well, he looks 50.
And I love his songwriting, and Lord knows he loves his songwriting.
Yeah.
So,
has he talked to you about his songwriting? He's a fan. He's a big fan of
Radney?
Yeah, Radney.
Of his own writing.
Of his writing.
Oh,
he's
yeah. Oh, in all different eras,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, and, yeah.
That's Radney, man. He's been cool even when it wasn't cool to be country. And even when it wasn't cool to be Texas. And even when it wasn't, yeah, like Barbara Mandrell.
Like Barbara Mandrell.
Like George Jones. He's like, so what I'm saying is Radney Foster is like Barbara Mandrell and like George Jones. He was country.
Radney is hot.
When country Radney wasn't even cool.
You know, in the course of the whole, your association in the music world, for me anyway, has always been a kind of a, it's got its ups and its downs, you know, its hills and valleys, and it's the times when you come together with something that you know works, and something that maybe, sometimes it's reconnecting with something, sometimes it's connecting brand new with it. Then that's a revival, and it gives you new energy and new strength to go on. So, great. So I could tell there was a lot of good mojo up there, you know, on the stage.
Years ago, we met, like, I think at a club in Nashville that Hootie and the Blowfish we were playing.
Darius and I have been friends since back in the Hootie and the Blowfish days. As a matter of fact, the way we met was my sister called me up in the middle of the night. Right when they were first getting started, they did this, like, half-hour live thing for VH1. And so my sister calls me up and goes, in the middle of the night, and says,
"This is so crazy, but turn on the TV right now on VH1. I think your T-shirt's on the lead singer of Hootie and the Blowfish."
And I started laughing. And I said, "I have no idea where they, I don't know if it's a free T-shirt. I don't know if they like what I do. I don't know anything about it."
We thought we were the only ones wearing Radney Foster T-shirts.
You know, I'd been a fan since Crazy Over You had come out. That had been a real big moment for me.
He came to a concert of yours and asked you to sing a particular song.
For me, I wouldn't be on country radio, I wouldn't be making country records, I wouldn't be doing that if it wasn't for hearing Radney Foster in 1986.
Oh, I didn't know him from Adam.
Yeah.
Nobody. We didn't know him. He was a kid in the audience.
Yeah,
you know?
He wasn't in a band, and nobody knew him. Yeah,
nobody knew him. He's working at a record store, and he had to close the record store down, so he's like an hour late into the show, and he catches like the last 45 minutes.
So, and they haven't played my song yet, so they're playing, and I'm yelling at the top of my lungs every chance I get. I'm yelling, "Play You Can Come Crying to Me." They're not playing it. They come back for an encore, and I look up, and they finish the first song, and I look at Radney, and I go, "Play, you can come crying to me." And we don't know each other at all. Radney goes,
"Dude, you know, we already played that song. You were late, man." You know, and he's like,
"I'm the only black guy in this place. You mean to tell me you can't play my song?"
I started laughing, and I looked at Bill. I go, "He's right."
So years later, we meet, and he says, he tells me that story. I go, "No, no, 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 no. You're that guy. I've remembered that guy all these years.
That was me."
So turned out they were really big fans, and I got to meet those guys and became really good friends with them. Wrote some of the songs. They actually recorded two or three of my songs.
Randy Foster and Al Green are my two biggest influences by far.
When I found out he got signed to Capitol and was making a country record, I called him up and I said, "This is perfect. You've been meant to do this. You've been a country singer your whole life, and you just didn't know it. You just had a rock band behind you." Because I love that guy's voice. He's got a thunderbolt for one, and he you know what? He also is just a straight up salt of the earth guy. I really have a lot of respect for him.
Angel Flight was something Randy called me and asked if I'd sing with him.
And I said, "Will you sing background vocals on this song with me again?" I said, "I'll send it to you and see if you can find a part." And he was like, he texted me back after I sent him the song. He's like, "I'll do it if I can just figure out how to stop crying." You know, it's like, you might have to edit me a lot.
My friend of Randy's written this great song, and you know, Randy's voice is so powerful, and he asked me if I'd come sing on it. And it was such an honor to be, first of all, for Randy to ask me to sing on his record was an honor, but to sing on that song was just amazing. And I hear it now, you know, and I get chills. It's one of those songs where I feel that song when I hear it. And Randy delivers it so well, and I'm proud to be a part of the project, really.
Andrews Tower, good morning. Angel Flight Bravo 02, ready for takeoff.
Angel Flight Bravo 02, you're number one for takeoff, runway 25. Get them home, boys.
Roger, Tower, clear for takeoff, runway 25.
Angel Flight was written by me and Darden Smith, who's a great singer-songwriter from Austin.
The way that we came up with Angel Flight was I had been talking with the National Guard about wanting to do a project using songwriting to work with them somehow. And in the course of our conversations, one of the people said, "Well, we have this thing, this group of people that flies the Angel Flight, and we would like to honor them." And as a songwriter, I mean, when someone says something like Angel Flight, I go, killer song title, you know? So I just went, well, during that conversation, I went, well, to me, there's your project.
The Angel Flights is what the Guard calls the flights that they carry their fallen brethren home to their final resting place.
And so then I had phone conversations with several pilots who fly this. And I basically, over the course of our conversations, I would just write down their words. The first line, "All I ever wanted to do was fly," it's a direct quote from a pilot.
It was after supper and the kids were, you know, going to bed and that kind of thing. And he just said, "Man," he said, "I could really use some help on this." And he said, he kind of played me what he had. And I said, I would be flattered and honored, you know.
It's interesting to write songs to a thing, as opposed to just writing songs that come out of your head. I mean, that song was purpose written.
It definitely was something that needed to ring true, and he and I had a long discussion just about that very fact.
And when a songwriter looks at you and goes, "The cockpit's quiet, the stars are bright, feels like church in here tonight," I mean, that's a pretty magic thing, you know, as a 47-year-old guy, quote, you know, writing poetry on the spot, that's pretty killer.
I need to do this song because that story needs to be told, and because it fits in with the theme of, you know, what's going on in my life. Well, I've got friends and family with friends and family overseas in harm's way, you know, fighting a war that, you know, people don't want to think too much about. It angers me, so I figured this was a good way to honor those guys.
All I ever wanted to do was fly, leave this world and live in the sky. I let the C-130 out of Fort Worth town. I go up some days, I don't wanna come down. Well, I fly that plane, call the Angel Flight. Come on, brother, you're with me tonight. between heaven and earth. You're never alone on the angel flight. Come on, brother, I'm taking you home. I love my family and I love this land, but tonight this flight's for another man. We do what we do 'cause we heard the call. Some gave a little, but he gave it all. I fly that plane called the Angel Flight. And come on, brother, you're with me tonight.
Come on, brother, you're with me tonight.
Between heaven and earth, you're never alone on the Angel Flight. Come on, brother, I'm taking you home. Come on, brother, I'm taking you home.
Farmer Center, good afternoon. Angel Flight Bravo 02 checking in level 290. We got a hero on board tonight.
Roger, radar contact. Godspeed.
Well, the cockpit's quiet and the stars are bright. Feels kinda like church in here tonight. It don't matter where we touch down. On the Angel Flight, it's sacred ground. When I fly that plane called the Angel Flight, got a hero riding with us tonight.
With us tonight.
Between heaven and earth, you're never alone on the Angel Flight. Come on, brother, I'm taking you.
Carson Tower, good afternoon. Angel Flight Bravo 02 is geared down 5 miles.
Angel Flight Bravo 02, you're number one for landing. Welcome home.
Angel Flight Bravo 02 is clear to land.
So, the name of this song is Trouble Tonight, and I wrote it with Jack Ingram.
I can sit here and talk for days about what a fan I am of Radney Foster.
When he and I get together, it's a fun time, usually.
It's just a song we wrote. We were just messing around. We were in Nashville in his basement, writing about wanting to go have some fun. I guess when you get down to it, you can't really have a whole lot of fun without getting in a little bit of trouble, too.
The song was inspired by, I tried to get my wife to go skinny dipping one night.
Seems a little instinctual. I'm not quite sure what you're getting at.
I was actually successful at it.
I'm sure he made that story up. He's a good storyteller.
Yeah, he did. Unless he's a good liar.
Okay, so that's not true?
No, I don't think so. No, that might have been Jack. You know, he wrote it with Jack Ingram.
Okay.
That might have been Jack's story with Amy.
Okay.
But he says that, I think it's one of those deals where when you get done writing a song like Trouble Tonight, you kind of have this deal where I'm going to tell my wife that it's about, we're trying to get your wife to do something stupid, and you tell your wife that it's about my wife, and that way, you know, catch him on the flip.
And when I told her that, she was like, you're making stuff up. And I said, no, there was. She said, oh yeah, we did go. It's like, so, and then she told me, she said, I thought that was my idea.
Go get in trouble tonight. Fool around until it feels just right. We've been busy being way too good, doing everything your mama says we should. But you and me, go get in trouble. That's you and me. Go get in trouble tonight. Really ain't good for me.
You shed a little light on it. You shed a little light on it. Take what's heavy on your heart and lay it out in plain sight. Shed a little light on it, it'll be alright.
Cindy and I were dating. She used to send me these cassettes that were mixed cassettes, and on one side
would be the Honky Tonk Saturday Night. The other side would be, you know, the gospel. Our bluegrass gospel revival.
And she would call those tapes Saturday night. It would, you know, be, say, Saturday night on one side and say Sunday morning on the other. You know, so this song, there is no gap on the record. You know, we intentionally married them together as a Saturday night, Sunday morning kind of thing.
San Antonio's country station, KJ97. Good morning. It's live at 7:05. You probably were first introduced to him as part of Foster and Lloyd. Of course, now he's been writing songs and performing for many years around the world and around Texas. Ladies and gentlemen, Radney Foster this morning.
So you're talking about revival. Where does the idea come from?
Well, it's actually sort of accidental and just life happening at the same time.
And I think a lot of people don't know that you've written songs that have been hits for other artists. I guess the one that sticks out in my mind the most, because it's one of my favorite songs, is "Raining on Sunday."
Thanks very much. Yeah, did. Keith Urban. You know, the story I always tell when I'm playing live is that, you know, it was a hit here at home for me in Texas, not much anywhere else in the world, till that Australian kid got a hold of it.
For me, the majority of my favorite writers all come from Texas. I don't know what that's about. It's a strange thing, from Don Henley to Radney to Rodney Crowell. There's just so many great writers from here. It's their ability to tell stories, and when you get a voice like Radney's, that's just so... I don't even know how to define Radney's voice, but it gets to me. The very first time I heard him, it got to me. There's a warmth and there's a family tone in his voice. That's the only way I can put it. He feels like family when I hear him.
It's almost easy sometimes to listen to the radio and hear a song and think, you know, somebody thought of that in a cubicle, you know, or you know,
or at a poker table.
Or at a poker table. Somebody just thought of that driving their car. Oh, that's a, you know, cute little hook for a song. And then you'll hear another song and think, oh my God, somebody lived that. You can tell. And maybe it's in the details, maybe it's in the subtleties, but yeah, you're right. A lot of Radney stuff, you feel that the ladder there where it's like, ooh, man, that hits me.
Gosh, it's been a long time.
Yeah,
it's
been
a long time. Dude, are you going to get up and sing tonight? On Raining?
Oh, God, okay.
Yeah.
You're kidding, yeah.
And I just do it acoustic.
Oh, okay, cool.
So it'd be very loose.
Okay, cool.
Very loose. Q plays, Chris McHugh kicks in halfway through with a little, like, electric drum kit. So it sounds like a loop.
Oh, oh, that's cool.
Oh my God, OMG.
Uh-huh.
You wouldn't believe. I got 18-year-olds.
Right,
and they went with their crew.
OMG.
OMG. Radney Foster just walked on stage. Tell us what that was all about.
He starts singing Raining on Sunday. And who does he introduce but the songwriter? And he gives a very nice introduction and says how many great singer-songwriters are here from the state of Texas. And he brings you Radney Foster on stage. And man, my wife is like, you know, clapping. And I'm like standing up for the first time and like, yes! Yes! And then I was like, man, let him do like six songs.
He also didn't tell me that the band starts to rip at the end of the song.
Keith had the crowd sing the last chorus, and he yanked my in-ear monitor out of my ear and grabbed me around the neck and goes, points at the crowd, at the 20,000 people, goes, listen to that.
To see that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Hi, folks. I'm Sam Bush, and welcome to the revival.
Right. Okay.
Terrific. Thanks a lot.
My youngest son got another chance. Due to my addiction, I didn't want him when I found out I was pregnant. So I done everything that I could think of to lose him. But he's still here. He just turned 6 in February, and we just found out like 3 weeks ago that he's mildly retarded. You know, at first I was real down about it, and at times I still beat myself up about it because it's my fault. And I know it, that he's going through all these different changes, and he loves me regardless, in spite of all my babies do. They do. And I have 4 beautiful children, so all my kids are a blessing to me.
Began in 1997, and we wanted to be a testimony to the truth that in the end, love and grace are the most powerful forces for change in the world, that there's nothing more powerful than that. When a community comes together and decides to love each other without judgment, without preconceived notions about what you need to be, how you need to be, but just love.
To me, revival means restoration, being reborn.
A powerful word. It's got a powerful meaning behind it.
Well, I'm gonna tell you, you know, I got so much gratitude going on.
If you want to talk about revival, this is really the place to see it in action. It's unbelievable. Just to see firsthand what just love can do to really change someone's lives, because a lot of these women have never felt any sense of self-worth at all. And just someone actually giving them the dignity, caring about them as a person, is really something to see.
I always had a heart for the women who were on the streets. I have a lot of compassion, and I would know exactly what I would want if I was living on the streets, how I would want to come off. Magdalene was the first witness to the good news of what resurrection looks like. And so the first witness to resurrection was a woman, and it was a woman who had suffered and a woman who knew about gratitude and grace. I don't care whether Mary Magdalene was a prostitute or not. I don't care if I was a prostitute or not. I don't care if you were a prostitute or not. I mean, we've all sold bits and pieces of ourselves for something else. But what I care about has been the idea of we take whatever the brokenness is in our lives and use that as the foundation for a powerful faith that is compassionate towards others.
That's my revival. I'm truly grateful for this program. It's just awesome.
Thistle Farms is a bath and body care company that started in 2001 from the community of Magdalene. And the reason was because there were so many arrests on so many of the women's records, it was really hard to get jobs. So people were getting clean and sober, but they were still broke. So we started the company in 2001. We wanted it to be all natural and wanted to be healing for the body. The thistle is a great noxious weed. It's a flower that grows on the streets where the women walk, you know, just those gangly, nasty thorns that grow so big, but it has this beautiful purple soft center. The extract from thistles is a detox for liver and regenerates the liver, actually, in some cases. So the amazing thing and the grace part of it for me was 8 years after starting this program, I learned that out of all the weeds in the world, we picked the very one that the women that were coming off the streets would need for healing. It's a great confirmation of you don't have to have a vision, you don't have to know where you're going. We are created to move towards healing. We're created that way if we're given the freedom. And if we keep moving towards that, we can't help but be better people.
So what does forgiveness mean to you?
It means giving myself a break because I'm too hard on myself. Giving others a break, not holding grudges. And that's hard. I hold grudges sometimes. But forgiveness means letting it go. It's an important song. And there's a line in it, "Sorry if the thing you needed most, I just couldn't give."
It's
It's a song called Suitcase, and I wrote it with Daryl Brown. It's the last song on the record. There's a little surprise reprise of Revival. It's a bluegrass version, all of us around one microphone, but in all reality, this is the last song of the CD. And I, from the very beginning, I knew that Revival and Suitcase would be the bookends, and everything else was going to have to figure out how it was going to fit. But I just think that, you know, I travel all the time, and so I know the joy of setting those bags down and, you know, having kids pile on top of you and a dog and the wife that loves you and that whole thing just overwhelming you. And it's one of the greatest feelings in the whole wide world for me. And but there's other ways we put our suitcase down. You know, I mean, I feel like this record has been about artistically putting my suitcase down and just saying, here I am, here's all the baggage, here's where I stand. You know, I think my father in the next world is able to put his suitcase down finally from all that pain that he went through in the end of his life. I think that, you know, the women you interviewed at Magdalen House, you got to feel like they've been able to put their suitcase down. You know, there's just so many ways in this, in the last several years for me, that I've just been like, it's like, I don't need to carry this baggage around any longer. I'm just going to put it down and leave them right where they are. And I can stop traveling.
Been traveling day and night on my own. My mind is weary and I hurt to the bone. Been too long since I felt at home. I can finally put my suitcase down. I've been restless since the day I was born, aching for something, but I don't know what for. But it feels like Gabriel just came and blew his horn, so I can finally put my suitcase down.
So, what do you think about it besides that?
I think it's kind of cool.
Yeah.
But really, I just don't really care. Like, if he was, like, my, I don't know, like, uncle or something, something like that, like, he wasn't really closely related to me.
Yeah.
Then I'd probably think it was a lot cooler. But, you know, he's just my dad.
Ultimately, when I think about Revival, I think about this right here. And, you know, they are my Revival. And he, you know, he's goofy.
Yeah.
And he's growing up and leaving the nest. And
I thought gluten-free was your Revival.
That might be part of it, yeah. That might be part of it, too. But, you know, she's a little lover potato.
Love her?
Yes.
My doll has a question.
Okay, what is it?
Does her hair look pretty? Because I worked on that for 2 days.
It looks beautiful, young lady. Okay. The, I think the hardest part is going to be that I have to go tour and that, you know, 3 or 4 days a week, I'm going to be away from home. So what I want to do is make the most of these relationships for the days that I do have at home. And
are you sure?
Yes. Yeah, absolutely.
Right now, I'm thinking maybe I should go out on the road.
Come on out. You go with it. We'll swap. Hi, I'm Radney Foster, and this is my Revival.
But you need both arms free when love grabs hold. I can finally put my suitcase down. I can finally put my suitcase down.
Honestly, I think this
I'm
is like,
looking at
it's like you said, starting over, starting fresh, and I like the getting your spirit on. It's basically bringing out the best inside of you and letting it out and starting over.
Glad to be here. Right.
Very glad to be here. Love you, Daryl.
I hate music.
Randy's paying me just to love Randy.
Love you too, Randy.
And who's the cameraman? Cameron.
I mean, Randy's bleeding. Mimi.
Skaters.
Skaters.
They love me, too.
Hang on. Ask it again.
Así es, ese es el perdón de corazón. No, no, nomás que lo hagas que yo te perdono, no. Hacerlo de corazón y brindarle cosas a aquel que te ofendió, para que él mire que hay amor.
When I grow up, I want to be a contortionist, a spy, a drummer, and maybe a guitar player, but that hasn't really worked out yet. Where's my agent? Kidding.
Thank you, dude. Watch out for the dog, too.
You know, that's where that revival, and that's when you come together with other fellow Christian brothers and sisters, and you get that uplifting, that Holy Spirit. That Holy Spirit is revival to me, you know?
Yeah. I'll come in there about a half hour before the choir, about 7:30, so I can yell at the band. What are you playing like? What are you doing? Come on, for God's sake.
You know what, I'm gonna make them have so much fun, they're gonna wanna stay.
They're gonna be, they're unbelievably sweet people. I'll turn up the camera.
Quiet moments just like this, when I think I'm on the road. It's the crazy ones when I'm losing it, but I don't know how you don't. And you use your gentle touch to show me the way. I want the faith you live. I want the joy you bring. I want to give my love the same way that you give. I want the song you sing. Music's always been my mistress, and you don't say a jealous word. The song you sing deep in your heart is the most beautiful I've heard. I need you to teach it to me. brand note. I want the faith you live. I want the joy you bring. I wanna give my love the same way that you give. I want the song you sing, the song you sing. I want the song you sing, the song you sing.